everybody out there. Welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson with Luis Scott-Vargas. We've got a lot to talk about when it comes to Worldwake spoilers today. Isn't that right?
Oh, yeah. There's a ton of new cards. Some of them awesome. Some of them awesomer.
Where to start?
We'll start with the cheapest card, Hada Freeblade, or Hada Freeblade, something like that.
Ooh, I like the jokes. Okay, all right.
I wish I had a Freeblade.
There you go.
On turn one. It's a one-drop ally that starts as a 1/2 because it triggers itself, and then gets bigger for every other ally. I think this guy is kind of making inroads for the first constructed ally deck, because already you've got, wait, we need X playing Kazandu Blade Master. Just four Blade Masters are the only allies, because by itself, a 2-mana, 2/2 First Strike Vigilance, and then if you ever draw two, one of them is a 3/3. So
it's a good start. I mean, that deck already has a bit of a start online. I played against it a lot. Again, the immediate interaction between Ranger of Eos and this new Freeblade.
Yeah, I mean, you grab two and you get a 1/2 and a 2/3, which that's not that impressive, but imagine
if you
have a
Blade Master
in play.
Exactly.
Now, so you've got a 4/4 Blade Master.
Is pretty huge. I mean, that deck has been teetering on playability.
Yeah,
now
we've got what looks like 8 playable allies, and who knows, maybe we'll get another one.
And I mean, you've got that deck, added something to its shell already, and now you've got one more card, which is our next card we're talking about today.
Core Firewalker.
Or more commonly known as...
Bearclaw.
Bearclaw, yes.
Obviously, once I heard that name, I just, won't stop saying it.
Yeah.
The reason, of course, it's both a bear and a dragon's claw, so Bearclaw.
And here we go. I mean, there's a lot of red in the environment right now. This guy seems quite poised to make the play.
Well, people already sideboard Dragon's Claw against red decks, and people already sideboard like Vidalkin Outlander against red decks. And this guy's both in the same card. So that's actually pretty unreal. It seems like you play this guy on turn two, I don't know how a mono red deck is going to beat you in standard. Like, they're going to play a Hellspark, you're going to gain a life, and then they attack into it. Wait, that doesn't work.
Yeah. So considering how good he is on his own, main deckable, you think?
It's possible. I mean, White Knight's getting main deck, and this guy's better against red than White Knight is against black, so you just have to figure out if you think there's going to be enough red for you to want a main deck.
I mean, a lot of my interest in this card right now, especially in standard, isn't even so much in the potential of a White Weenie deck, but in the Boros deck by itself, being able to Lightning Bolt gain a life, or better yet, in the Boros mirror, that guy seems huge.
Yeah, it's actually, I don't think that unbelievable. Step Lynx is still going to beat the hell out of you.
There are red spells in the deck, Luis. He does do something.
Yeah, I think it's okay. I don't think it's necessarily huge. It's decent. But I think the fact that you're even considering main decking this guy shows how good he is. Because, again, when you play against a red deck, this guy is going to do a ton of work for you.
Okay. So we talked about a couple of white kids.
His biggest flaw is that he doesn't cost blue.
Yeah. You with the islands again. Fine, then. Let's talk about a blue card.
All right. Mysteries of the Deep. That's a card which I even previewed a bit in my article previewing Admonition Angel. And I think I'm basically restating it. It's probably good enough for standard.
It's very controversial.
If you crack a fetch, you're paying 5 mana at instant speed to draw 3 cards, and you're not going to do better than that.
A lot of people are not on the fence. They've picked a side. They're like, it's overcosted. I don't want to draw 2 during my opponent's turn, and drawing 3 during my turn, tapping
well,
out.
The thing
not
is,
that good.
Right now, I actually like the counterspell standard has to offer. You've got negate, flash freeze, essence scatter, double negative, and like the Grixis deck, for example, that I'm playing has all of those in it. But what it doesn't have is a way to use its mana when the opponent doesn't play anything, and Mysteries of the Deep gives you an out for that. And add in the fact that paying 5 mana at sorcery speed to draw 3 cards, I mean, I was playing Mindspring in blue, I read. And
yeah. Concentrate seems just fine in this format.
Yeah.
And it's in no way a drawback to be able to cast it during your opponent's turn
right.
For maybe something less, maybe the
and
exact
I mean,
same effect.
I mean, sure, Grixis only has 4 fetch lands, but if you're playing 2 Mysteries of the Deep, you just have to time it right. And just, again, sorcery speeding is not the end of the world. So I think the card is decent and we'll see play.
Excellent.
Moving on, we've got Omnath, Locus of Mana. It's our first of our mythics. At a green and 2 for a 1/1. Green mana doesn't empty from your mana pool, and he's ++1 for each green mana in your mana pool.
So an exciting card in a way that it breaks the rules of the game.
Right, it's Upwelling plus Wake Thresher, kind of. As in, it's a 3-mana 1/1 that gets a lot bigger, as time passes.
I'm still trying to find the home for this card. Like, it seems like it could have a powerful effect.
Well, first, let's take a look at what you need. It needs to be a deck that has access to almost all green mana, possibly a small splash, but more than likely mono green. It's a deck that's interested in having, a huge monster. And it's a deck that can afford not to spend a ton of its mana or, generates a ton of mana. So, yeah, you can't curve out. Playing him turn 3, then turn 4, tapping 4, attacking for 5, then playing a guy, I mean, that's okay. That's more like a Wake Thresher, but if you're spending your mana every turn, I don't know if this guy's worth it.
He has a big target on his face
right.
Every time you go to cast.
Just like Wake Thresher, which, saw some play, but wasn't as good as people thought. It wasn't a 3-mana 4-4 or 5-5.
I mean, we've got Leatherback Baloth to give this guy a little bit more of a support
Ooh,
for the
that's
mono
true.
Green.
I forgot about that guy.
How could you forget about that guy? And we also have Elvish Archdruid, which is in plenty of constructed
right,
decks
so that Elvish Archdruid is the second part. He generates a ton of mana. when you can generate, you know, 6 or 7 mana a turn, yeah, Omnath looks a lot better. If counter-based control decks get better, he becomes good too, because if you slip him out and manage to land him, in 2 turns you can cast, you know, an Ant Queen and a Master of the Hunt in the same turn, and they can't counter both, for example.
After you attack for 9.
I mean, this deck doesn't sound like it does well against Jund, but I mean, what deck that really does?
Jund's slowly slipping out of the metagame. Other decks are coming in there. It's like, yeah. Forests by themselves might have a chance in Worldwake.
It's possible, but... I mean,
it's the second card that's a very heavy green commitment that seems like it's a powerful card.
Right. Moving on, we've got a Vintage card, which I think will become, you know, quite playable.
I'm very excited about
maybe
this
card. Maybe not to a staple, but anyway, we've got Lodestone Golem.
Lodestone Golem. Sphere Resistance meets Juggernaut, and they make love forever. That card,
yeah.
I love it a lot. I mean, I'm a huge fan of playing stacks. I'm a huge fan of playing stacks.
I mean, I couldn't imagine why people ever wanted to cast Juggernaut in Type 1, but this guy is a lot more than a Juggernaut. He's, like you said, also a Sphere. And so being able to play this guy and have pressure plus disruption in the same package makes Mission's Workshop decks pretty happy.
It's the all-around threat to me. I mean, if you get two of those guys in play against the blue decks...
I mean, stacks sometimes had the problem of drawing too many, like, lock pieces and no way to finish them.
Yeah.
Or a bunch of Juggernauts and Triskelions and just, you know, them casting tendrils. So this guy does a pretty good job filling both roles.
Yeah, like, vanilla threat, and you're like, vanilla threat, and your opponent's like, really? That's all you're going to do? I think I'm just going to go off now.
Yeah, and I mean, and he stacks in multiples, and, you know, he stacks in multiples. Yeah.
Oh, oh, oh.
And I mean, I can't imagine that you have enough time to get 3 of them out before it kills them. But
who needs three?
But 2. I mean, casting 1 on turn 1 and 1 on turn 2 puts them on like a 2.5 turn clock, 3 turn clock, and you know, all their spells cost more.
It's a great card. I'm looking forward to playing it in Vintage.
Yeah, I think it's very good. All right, so now we get the best card we've seen so far.
The Taste of Resistance, the thing that we've been talking about most all day.
Abyssal Persecutor.
The big guy.
Black 2, 6/6 Flying Trample, and Platinum Angels them. So they can't lose. You can't win.
Perfect way to put it.
I think this card is absurd. By itself, sure, it can't kill them. It can put them to negatives, though, which is something important to remember. They don't go to 0, they go to negatives. So, I mean, you might as well put them in like negative 30 so they gain some life, they don't live.
Keep coming for a little while until you're nice
and then, as long as he's on the board, you know, or they can't win until if he ever gets removed from the board. So, sure, you can't put him in every deck. You have to have ways to kill him, but Black has plenty of ways to kill its own creatures. Gatekeeper of Malakir, you can target yourself. Fleshbag Marauder, Terminate.
Huge cards. This guy definitely looks like he's going to be impacting aggressive strategies. He's going to be a lot of fun to play with, against, a lot of decisions to be made.
So, I mean, like, let's say you play this guy and your opponent has a Terminate. They're not going to want to take 4 hits from him. They're going to have to Terminate him, in which case, you know, he's just a big guy who got killed.
Exactly.
No drawback.
Yeah. It's like,
but imagine you already put them in negatives and you have this guy in play. Since their life is dependent on him being in play, they can't kill him. If they've got a bunch of creatures out, they can't ever attack with a guy who's big enough to kill him. And they have to attack, like, through the guy. They can't remove him from the game or anything.
He's very exciting. My only problem with the card is it has this stupid creature type that is somehow a clause in this format right now. Stupid demon.
Oh, because Baneslayer.
It just happens to be
I think it's a little gratuitous that Baneslayer has protection from this guy for no reason.
I really think that Wizards is jamming it down our throat that, you know, these seemingly worthless abilities now matter. I mean, Halo Hunter was kind of the initial throw.
Well, that was just a joke that Halo Hunter can't kill Baneslayer.
Exactly. It was a laugh. It was like, ha ha ha, look, it has protection from this card.
Yeah, but I think Black is still good at killing creatures, so they can still kill the Baneslayer.
It's just an annoying roadblock I'm not looking forward to.
No, I agree. I think, in general, this card is just going to be very, very good. The only kind of decks that might not want it are like really aggressive decks, because if you've already got enough guys to kill them and you play this guy, that all that does is give them more time. But in general, I would look for him to be one of the best cards in Worldwake. I think he's going to be very strong.
Sweet. So. All right. Well, until next time, we're going to have a lot more Worldwake spoilers
coming
at you.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Hopefully they're as good as this guy. And
definitely.
Plus, remember, Bearclaw. Thanks for watching, everyone.
Word of the day, Bearclaw.